everyone, assalamu alaikum, welcome back to Dr. Teeth. Today we are going to learn about a very important concept, that is the ferrule effect. Now, what is a ferrule? The literal meaning of the word ferrule is an iron bracelet. So you can imagine it to have a strengthening effect. But what is this ferrule in dentistry? Let us understand this with an example. We have a patient. He has an endodontically treated tooth. Now, you have to restore this tooth. You have to do tooth preparation and you have to give a crown to this patient. So if we have enough tooth structure, we'll go ahead and do our preparation, make an impression and then have the prosthesis made. But what if the tooth structure is compromised? So in that case, we have to see whether we have that minimum sound tooth structure present or not. So we have to basically see whether ferrule is present or not. So what is a ferrule? It is a band of sound tooth structure that remains above the gingival margin after you do the tooth preparation. So this amount of tooth structure should be there for you to do post-encore and proceed with the impression. So when we get our final crown and we place it on the tooth, as you can see, we will have a 360 degree encirclement of this crown. Means it will be bracing the underlying tooth structure like a bracelet. Now a question arises, how much should the ferrule be? So the ferrule has to be 1.5 to 2 mm above the prepared margin. So the height should be minimum 1.5 to 2 mm. It also has to have a certain thickness because you have to go and put a post there, right? So we need to have a thickness of the dentine. So it has to be more than 1 mm in thickness. Okay, and preferably the ferrule should be present 360 degree around the tooth. Okay, this is preferable, but this is not mandatory. In certain cases, if the tooth structure is missing on some portions, let's say on the mesial aspect, distal aspect, we can still do without it, but we'll see what terms and conditions are applied. But for now, let us understand that the ferrule has to be 1.5 to 2 mm in height and more than 1 mm in thickness and preferably should encircle the tooth all around, that is 360 degrees. So if the tooth does not have this minimum ferrule height and width, you cannot restore that tooth and it will go for extraction. So if you don't have the proper ferrule height, you need to go for crown lengthening or orthodontic extrusion. If that is not possible, then the only option is extraction and then replacement of that edentulous space. Now moving on to the advantages of ferrule. Why is it important? Why we need that sound tooth structure? Why we shouldn't give a crown just by placing a post, adding a core? Let us see. So here we have two conditions. In the first one, the ferrule is present. In the second one, the ferrule is absent, as you can see here. So when we have forces acting on the tooth having the ferrule, the forces are well tolerated by the tooth structure. But in the case where the ferrule is missing or is not sufficient, the dentine of the root will have a lot of shearing forces, especially at the apex region. So what will happen? We will have fracture. So there are high chances of root fracture at this region. Advantages of ferrule: it increases the fracture resistance of the tooth and it provides a bracing effect to the tooth. It also increases the mechanical resistance. Now, what if we don't have that 360 degree ferrule? Means we have ferrule partially. There are certain terms and conditions apply, but still we'll be able to restore many of the teeth which are having partial ferrule. For this, we will have to understand the forces acting on each tooth. Let us start with the maxillary incisors. Now, imagine the forces acting on your maxillary incisor. The forces are directed labially outward and it is the palatal surface of the teeth that will be resisting this force, right? So it is mandatory for us to have a ferrule along the palatal aspect. So for maxillary incisor, even if you have a palatal ferrule, still we can go ahead and restore it. For mandibular anteriors, try to bring your lower mandible forward. You will understand that the mandibular anteriors have the forces from the labial aspect. So in this case, we need labial ferrule. For the maxillary premolars, we'll consider the canine guided occlusion and the mutually protected occlusion. Mutually protected occlusion is when most of your teeth on one side touch when you do lateral movement. So here, the ferrule on the buccal palatal aspect is important. Mesial distal is not that important, because you can imagine that the forces are acting more on the palatal side as well as on the buccal side. For the mandibular premolars, the buccal wall ferrule is the most important. Now coming to the molars, here the maximum forces are in the vertical direction. In addition, we also have a buccolingual force component when we consider the side-to-side movement. So as with the maxillary premolar, here also the buccal and the lingual or palatal wall is most important. Proximal walls are not that important. It's better to have them, but if you don't have any option, it's okay. So this was all I had to share in this video. In the next video, hopefully, I will try to cover what kind of post should we give for the anterior teeth and what kind of post we should give for the posterior teeth. If you want it, let me know in the comment section below so that I can understand if you want a video on that. If yes, I'll be making it. Otherwise, I might skip it. I hope you found this video helpful. I'll see you in the next video. Take care. Al-Hafiz.